Well, I'd like to start off by saying what a diverse, fascinating series of papers. Relationship between sound, score, image, and interdisciplinary approach to relationship between sound, our thinking about sound and language, and again, of course, ideas around repetition. I think that it would be most appropriate to give you an opportunity to ask questions, because of course we could conduct a whole discussion amongst ourselves, but I'm very aware that we are pressed for time, and so I would like to ask some questions from you. Ruth has a question.
I've got a question for, well, it's for all of you, but for Irene. I was really interested in your description of the written score as two-dimensional, and I wanted to ask you a bit about that, but across all of you, because this issue of the written score being something, and Anaya Lockwood's statement that you look at a score and then you do it, I think that is something that is quite interesting in relation to the idea of looking and reading, and a score being a two-dimensional thing. Because I'm interested in the typographic arrangement of these scores and the significance of that, and particularly in the last piece, I thought this idea of the structures and the grid lines of Hannah Dahl-Bowman's work and the significance of that. And I think with all these works, that's something that is really under thought about, is the extent to which these text scores are actually two-dimensional. Because when I look at them, I see them as absolutely not two-dimensional, much more three-dimensional in their arrangements, and the way in which you absolutely have to read them is not a fixed two-dimensional thing. So I don't know if anyone wants to say anything about that a bit more.
I guess, yeah, I completely agree, and I suppose making this simple distinction between those two modes is also a schema for me. It's not absolute. I mean, there's a huge amount of blurring between reading and performance, and I guess I mean two-dimensional in terms of display as a curator, perhaps, and like literally we've pasted facsimiles or blow-ups of the scores to the wall. I'm not sure I have... I guess for me, particularly in terms of these particular materials I'm looking at, I feel like that's not so distinct, and that's, and you experienced the workshop a couple of weeks ago, and that's something that that workshop was trying to draw out, both as a way of looking at these kinds of works, but also for me as a curatorial mode to chair these kinds of works. And I feel like in that situation, the sort of line between reading and performance is sort of completely dissolved, really. Hope that answers my thoughts.
I think it is a very interesting and quite a complex question, because you have the literality of the paper or what it's written on, and the decision-making processes of how to present that, and then for the viewer, the beholder, it becomes something which is carrying on inside one's head. And that is immediately a sort of spatial interaction, intervention. It's a complex play between that, how we read what we read, and what that happens with what we're reading, because it doesn't remain flat, it doesn't remain two-dimensional in any context, I would say. Do we have any other questions? I can see.
Thank you. I just want to hear more about how you will relate all this fantastic work to our contemporary context today. So how should we place the urgency of reading these all these work produced in 70s, 60s, 70s, 80s in like today contemporary environment?
You should go and see the show at Chelsea Space. I don't mean that as like I've answered the question. Rather that me and Irene have made a real concerted attempt to kind of interweave the relationships between certain modes of production that maybe speak to certain practices that are being enacted now. So we have contemporary works from Charlotte Prodger, Claire Potter, Tai Shani, Beatrice Gibson, in direct relationship to historical material from Anaya Lockwood, Alison Knowles, Carolee Schneeman, for example, Vika Shomi. I think we're quite open about the fact that we're just, that quite a lot of what we're doing is speculative, and I think maybe this speaks a little bit of what Ruth's question was before. The idea of kind of these things being fixed in any kind of interpretation, I think, goes against the possibilities that the texts open up in and of themselves. And so the idea of performance within text, I think specifically for Schneeman, for example, there's a literal embodiment that goes on as much as a physical embodiment of performance. So there's two modes that are existing simultaneously, and these things are also broadly speculative. The text parts of what he has only exists as a text, it doesn't exist as a performance. So you can draw your own conclusions from how that might have actually played out should it have been actually produced. So those things are going on in historical context, but those types of thoughts are going through quite a lot of contemporary works as well. Writing is something that artists do and will do and continue to do. So I guess that's what we're looking at within our exhibition, I suppose. Sorry, I'm like answering for Irene, it's ridiculous. So yeah, that's what we have done to enact that contemporary context, I think. So if you go and have a look at the exhibition, it's kind of clearer.
I'll just add that I think also we have to insist on performances of this work sometimes. So, and this returns somewhat to the former question. So Darboven, that was an active choice to begin translating her writing work and her mathematical prose back to music. And she is not one who speaks very deeply about, you know, her own process, but certainly that was a deliberate choice. And I think that it is important to examine the sonorous dimension of a lot of these events, or specifically musical scores, and to see the vision of the scores, just to hear the sound of the scores, and to consider them separately and together.
I should also add that we did actually have a performance day that corresponded to the show, so there is this idea of performance being something that is active in and out of the gallery space. And I think Irene's presentation, when she was talking about diffraction, speaks really kind of coherently to that idea of iteration, perhaps. Perhaps I should pass it to Irene.
I was just going to add that I think any work that is involved or focuses or centres from the body quite clearly bears a relation to the presentations that we've had, and that they may be focused more on work that was made in the relatively recent past. But those pressing urgencies of how we think about our bodies are as much present now as they were then.
Do we have time for one more question? Yes.
Just a somewhat polemical question, and that is there any danger in placing all of this work under the rubric of feminist art or even women's art, for instance, rather than in the larger framework of conceptual art of the period? For instance,
I'm sure everyone would like to say something. I'd just like to say that a lot of the work that we've been looking at has been made, well, it's been made by women practitioners, and that a lot of the contexts of those women's practice has only comparatively recently been in a position to be examined. And so to take it out of the traditional focus of a much more male-orientated context or scene is to enable this work to be recast for the significance that it has. So, I mean, for example, when I was speaking about Christine Kozlov earlier, Adrian Pfeiffer and many of these other artists, they would be literally like one or two women in an exhibition of 30. They might even be all men exhibition, or there could be an exhibition out of, say, 50 or 70 that has three women in it. So I think it's quite necessary to spend a good deal of time focusing on that and to sort of redress that situation so that we're able to really experience it. We have time for a couple
Can
of
I
comments.
Just, a quick follow-up in the feminist show that was at, I guess, PS1 in 2008. The problem, I mean, the trouble is there as well. I mean, you know, a lot of this work, for instance, the last speaker, all four of those speakers are very much central in the canon by now at institutions in New York and so forth. So there is some trouble, and it's worth staying with the trouble.
Yeah, there's always trouble. And we can carry on this.